शरीरस्यतवैद्यकेन योपाकरोत्तं प्रवरं मुनीनां पतञ्जलिं प्राञ्जलिरानन्दोऽस्मि आपाकुरुषागारं शङ्खचक्राधिधारिणं सहस्रशिरसं श्वेतं प्रणमामि पतञ्जलिम् श्रीमते अनन्ताय नागराजाय नमो नमः श्रीकृष्णवागीश यतीश्वराभ्यां सम्प्राप्तचक्राङ्कणभाष्यकारं श्रीनृत्नरङ्गेन्द्र यतो समर्पितस्त्वम् श्रीकृष्णमार्य गुरुवर्यमीडे तिरोधे कार्तिके मासे शतताराकृतोदयं योगाचार्यं कृष्णमार्यं गुरुवर्यमहं भजे कृष्णसूनीतया पात्रं ज्ञानवैराग्यभूषणम् श्रीमद्वेङ्कटनाथार्यं वन्देहं लोकजेतिकम् श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः सदेको सघनः भवतु सघनौ भुनक्तु सगवीर्यं करवावहै तमस्तु मापिषावकै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः शन्नो मित्रशम्भुनः शन्नो भवत्पर्यमा शन्न इन्द्रो बृहस्पतिः शं नो विष्णुरुक्रमः नमो ब्रह्मणे नमस्ते वायो त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्मासि वामेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्म वदिष्यामि ऋतं वदिष्यामि सत्यं वदिष्यामि भवतु तद्वक्तारमवतु अवतु माम् अवतु वक्तारम् ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः I've been given an hour. I first want to thank Dr. Ramesh for giving me this opportunity. We have been discussing this for quite some time about how to go about this. This is actually should have happened some time ago. My format is, if you want, you can ask me questions first, or otherwise I will leave the questions toward the end. Certainly there should be some communication because that should not be one-sided thing. And second point is, to talk about pranayama itself within an hour is not going to be wholesome. I'll try to make an introduction into the topic. And I'm trying to find out whether I can give you some 5 minutes of experience of some aspect of pranayama. Let me see how this is, because the way we are seated here. Basically, let us take it that this is an introduction, very basic introduction to pranayama. My job, in the moment I thought of it, how I want to introduce this topic, I've been thinking about it for quite some time. I have occasions to talk on yoga topics in a number of forums, but every forum is different. So how to introduce this topic? So the introduction was made a bit simpler for two reasons. One is as the Namaskaram to the Acharya was done, I think all of you, those of you who have been repeating, you would have seen the words that came, Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama, Pratyahara, Dharana, Dhyana, Samadayana, Ashtau, Angani, Anushtana, that is the word I saw. This is the first time I am hearing this. So, this particular Acharya Parampara of the Sringeri mind has the unique distinction of following the Ashtanga Yoga, and that is stated here in this. Number two is my teacher, that my teacher is Deshikacharya, his teacher, that is Paramaguru for us, is Krishnamacharya, and in whose name is our Yoga Institute, Krishnamacharya Yoga Mandir. For those of you, some of you would have known him, he lived 100 years was in Chennai in his last day. He has written a book called Yoga Makaranda, in which he is only book available in Tamil, but 1930s it was published. It talks about the various postures, yoga postures. There are about 58 postures or so in that, in Tamil. It was originally written in Kannada, translated into Tamil. In that, in the introduction, actually, he says he learned yoga in the Himalayas under a yogi called Ram Mohan Brahmachari. Actually, it was very near Kailash Mansarovar, and we are talking about 70-80 years and what back. And he trekked all the way to near Kailash to God. And also, in that book, he says that at the time when Sringeri Math had one of the acharyas, probably the 2-3 acharyas prior to that, there were 700 postures which were practiced there. 700 postures. And he talks about how many postures were there. That's a question we have. Now we are seeing so many yoga asanas, postures. How many are there? So many questions will come. You know? He says there were 7,000 and at least 700 were practiced. He says, I saw it in the Sringeri Acharya Parampara, and he was associated with. He even says, I learned. So, this particular parampara has a very close link with the Ashtanga Yoga. And Pranayama is one of the angas of the Ashtanga Yoga. So, Yama, Niyama, Asana, and fourth is Pranayama. Pratyahara, Dharana, Dhyana, Samadhi. This is the Ashtanga Yoga, which is a pathway laid out properly by Vedic scriptures, and it was brought out by Patanjali in his Yoga Sutra. In fact, he said, I am not the one who is giving this Ashtanga Yoga for the first time. It has been in existence, Anushasana, Athar, Yoga, Anushasana. This is there for quite a number of years, millions of years. I am now putting it into a particular format. So that is called as Yoga Sutra. In fact, it is called as Padanjala Yoga Darshana because it shows the way. It is one of the darshanas, Shad Darshana. In that, in the second chapter called the Sadhana Pada, that is the Pada, the chapter relating to practice, this Ashtanga Yoga comes, which is considered to be the pathway, marga, yoga marga, for reaching the highest. Yoganga Anushtanatri Ashuddhikshaye Jnana Deeptihi Aviveka Khyadehe. It gives Viveka. It is an endless Viveka. It continues. At the end of the Viveka, when Viveka culminates, it ends in Kaivalya, and that is totally Dukkha Nivarana. So, in this Ashtanga Yoga, we can make these 8 limbs for the purpose of practice into some segments. Yama and Niyama relates to external and internal discipline. They are to be followed throughout. There is no question of saying that I will practice Ahimsa which is non-violence, you know, between this time and this time, 6 o'clock to 7 o'clock. It is continual. Anybody who wants to take to the path of yoga has to continuously practice the yama and niyama. There are 5 subsects in yama and niyama. If I take that, it will take that. Let us understand, it is external discipline, non-violence, not causing injury to others, speaking truth, ahimsa, satya, asteya, non-stealing, brahmacharya, control of senses, aparigraha, not receiving more than what is required, shauta, this is yama, external discipline, niyama is shauta, cleanliness, santosha, contentment, tapas, austerity, swadhyaya, this is swadhyaya. Swadhyaya is anything that is relating to taking one towards the highest. Vedic chanting, mantra chanting, swadhyaya, ishvara pranidhana, submission to the highest self. Now, this is the faith on which 2 pillars are there. One is asana, another is pranayama. When this asana and pranayama are practiced, with the base of the yama and niyama, then it leads one to pratyahara, internal control of the senses. And that will further lead to concentration, meditation and integration. The concentration which is known as dharana, meditation known as dhyana, integration known as samadhi, they are together kept in one and we call loosely as meditation, meditation. Please teach me meditation. So this is the 3 together in the Ashtanga Yoga. So if you take the 3 separately and make it into meditation, then we get pratyahara, which is control of senses. Then come, below that comes the pranayama. As you can see by now, pranayama is almost in the middle. Yama, niyama, asana. Then comes pranayama, which is the 4th. Then pratyahara, dharana, dhyana, samadhi. So, the very idea of placing it, even though it is not a step-by-step movement, it is not that I will complete, it is not like I finish LKG, UKG like that. I will finish Yama this year, next year Niyama, next year Asana. It is Anga. Anga means parts of the body. It is like parts of the body. They are together practiced and they grow in that way. But in that, there is a sequence of 4 chapters. There is a sequence in this. The sequence starts, as I told you, Yama and Niyama are the base. The sequence starts with asana and pranayama and dhyana. I will leave pratyahara. So we are looking at the television and everywhere, and mostly we commonly know yoga means asana, yoga means pranayama, yoga means dhyana. It's not wrong. They are not wrong. But to look at them separately is wrong. They are integrated, they are together. So pranayama is in the middle with 3, 4, 3, 4 later and 3 former. On these 3, the asana has a role to play with pranayama. And that is the reason why pranayama has been placed in the middle. So asana is a preparation for pranayama. Asana is a preparation for pranayama, and pranayama is a preparation for dhyana. And pranayama is a preparation for dhyana. So anything that we start, we have a way of doing. So there is a formal way. So we came in, we had prayer, so we got some sessions in the beginning. Now I am starting. Even here there is a format. When everything is done with a format, the results are going to be assured. And it will be straight take to the goal. So the format here is pranayama comes in between asana as a preparation and pranayama becomes a preparation for dhyana. So for any normal human beings, it is ideal and it is recommended that you follow this sequence. You follow this sequence. I am going to quote some of the things about how, why it is required. So this is the idea of pranayama. Pranayama is generally a Vaidika karma. Apart from being a part of Ashtanga Yoga, which is a part of the Ashtanga Yoga, it's a Vaidika karma. In fact, in India, in the ancient India, everything was based on Vedas, and there are karmas to be done by everyone. In any Vaidika karma, you can see pranayama has an important role. So when the Purohit comes, Shastri comes, he will come home and he will ask the Yajamana, the person, to say, do pranayama. So immediately, sometimes in the earlier days, people were doing properly. Now the people don't understand even Sanskrit. So pranayama, the pranayama, the priest says, he's saying, please do pranayama. So they are, because the person doesn't understand Sanskrit, he will say pranayama. Then he will say, no, no, this is not to be repeated. You are supposed to do pranayama now. Okay. How do I do? Let's just hold them. Hold your hand, hold your nose with your hand. And most of the time, we think that pranayama means holding the nose by the fingers. Most of the time, and a lot of people will come to us and ask us, when are you going to teach me pranayama? He said, you are already doing pranayama. No, you are not made me hold the nose by the finger. So this is an impression. Impression is not wrong. Holding the nose by the hand is one type of pranayama. It is a technique. Pranayama doesn't start there. Pranayama starts elsewhere. What is pranayama then? So he said, Vaidika karma. Let me tell you that the reason why we have lost out this pranayama in our lifestyle, day-to-day activity, is because often Vaidika karmas are excluded for some people. When the moment the Vaidika karmas are excluded, I can tell you it is for women even. So a boy is introduced into Sandhyavandana and immediately he has to do postures and he has to do pranayama in the 4th year or 6th year or 7th year earliest. So everyone has to start the pranayama in the maximum of 7th year. That was what it was happening. Now because it was excluded, it has gone away. So what is this pranayama? The word, it's a Sanskrit word. Sanskrit words have got special meaning. So it's a pranayama. It has to be lengthened. Pranayama. So it is divided into two parts. Prana ayama. The correct way of dividing it, pranasya ayama, pranayama. Prana ayama. Prana, I think the word looks like every one of us know what is prana. So we are all here sitting, that is because of prana. If prana is not there, I think we will not be here. And so prana has an important role. It is energy. It is not simply energy. It is life energy. Any energy, form of energy that you see, it comes from prana. Whether it is going to be even electricity. So any form of energy, there should be some source from which everything is coming. The form, the source from which any energy is coming, electromagnetic, or even any other type of energy that you are looking at, the source, they say, it is from prana. Prana is a separate segmented one. In the evolution, Vedic evolution, prana separately considered to be evolved. In fact, Prashna Upanishad talks about the first of the creation from Brahma, and he creates Rayi and Prana. So Prana is created. There is another Upanishad which is called Narayana Upanishad, not the usual Narayana Upanishad. There is called another Narayana Upanishad. Atha Purusho Gavai Narayano Kamayata Prajashrite Dheti Narayanat Pramano Jayate. The Supreme Being called Narayana decided that he will become many. That's how the creation comes. And the first thing that comes out is prana. And you all know in Purusha Sutta, prana vayurajayata. So prana exists separately. It is the source. When it is in you and me, that is the prana which is responsible for all the activity. If you are seeing, if you are hearing, it is because of the prana inside. Sometimes that is why we say, if you have not eaten for some time, repeat with me and say, I'm not hearing what you are talking. Why you are not able to hear? That is because your prana has come down. So this prana, ayama, ayama means extending, stopping. Two meanings for the same word, ayama, extend, stop. And both have link. Stop means just stopping. If you just stop your breath, that is stopping. You can do that. Extending means extending by a particular measurement. Why should both be together, you know? And generally when there are two meanings in Sanskrit, there should be some link also. So when you want to hold something, you can hold it straight away, you can hold it straight across, or you can extend and hold. So you can extend and hold. It becomes a pranayama when you extend and then hold it. So the technique of extending and holding is found in the ayama, meaning of the word ayama. Now, in us, what is this prana in us? In us, where is this prana? What it is doing? What is the function? I told you the function in general, normal terms, I told you. It is the life. In fact, in Hatha Yoga Pratipika, one of the texts, it says, what is death? Death is viyogam of the deha prana. Deha prana viyogam. That is a segmentation. Viyogam means separation. A separation of the prana from the body. That is why we say pranam koyate in Tamil. So when somebody dies, we say pranam koyate. That means the prana has left. The prana leaves the body. So when the prana leaves the body, the person is considered dead. So that is the life energy, that which is giving us life, that which is responsible for all the functions, including our sleep. Even including the sleep, the function, if you consider a sleep, is considered as one of the vritti. It is considered as a function of the mind. It is a function of the mind. Even for a sleep function, prana is required. That is why in sleep, we continue to have prana. Otherwise, we will be dying every day and we will be born again every day. But we are not dying every day. So, prana is there for every function. Whether you are thinking, whether you are hearing, whether you are talking, moving, everything, prana is required. And how do we get this prana? Let us first understand, how do we get this prana? We are born with prana naturally. As a child, the moment the child gets life, prana goes inside, isn't it? So it is there, and there are three things which sustain the prana. And it is very simple. You don't have to read books. One is food, anna. Second is up, water. The third is breath, air. Air, when it is going into the human system, it is called breathing. When we say breath, it is the air. So there are three ways in which you get prana. If you don't eat for some time continuously, if you fast, you can live for so many days. After that, one will have to breath. So one, if the one decides not to eat, they can live for how many days? It is there some 18 days or 20 days. After that, the person can live on water for a longer period. After that also, a person can live on air for some time. So, in fact, in the ancient days, in Ramayana, they say, in the Rishi segment, there were Rishis who were Appakshi, Vayu Pakshi. They were living only on water and air. So, water and air is responsible for prana. Apo vayu, apo va prana. Annamayamki saumyamana. So, when the food is taken, it becomes prana. When water is taken, it becomes prana. When you inhale air, you are taking prana. So, there are three sources by which you are taking prana. So, you can control the prana through all the three. So if you eat, you will be able to have prana, but we won't be able to eat continuously. So there is a limitation. And with water also, there is a limitation. But with air, there is no limitation, and air is the most important segment through which we take the prana. Whether you take water, whether you take food, if you don't inhale and exhale, you won't be able to be alive. So this part of the air, which is the source of prana, is the most important part. So prana is responsible. Pranayama means extending, stopping the prana. And prana is the life energy. And this life energy, as I told you, we have two segments. In the ancient Indian philosophy, as well as Vedic wisdom, they said in every one of us, we have got a Purusha. Purusha means not a name. Purusha means consciousness, chit, atma, soul. These are all the words. There are more words. So this Purusha, which is consciousness, which is living inside, he is living in a body. And that body is called Prakriti because it is made up of the Panchabhuta. So for every one of us, including animals and plants, there is a consciousness inside, which is Purusha. In fact, for that Purusha's purpose only, the body is working. The body is working for the purpose of the Purusha. Now, how this Purusha and this Prakriti are linked now? They are completely, distinctly different entities. And the different characteristics, in fact, they are divided completely. The Purusha is eternal. The Prakriti is not eternal. The Purusha does not undergo change. The Prakriti undergoes change. The Purusha is not made up of the three gunas. The Prakriti is made up of the three gunas. So you can see they are completely different. But how these completely different two entities have been linked? How can they be linked? They are linked by this prana. That is why the moment the prana leaves, the atma also leaves. Prana is called Atma Sakha. Prana is called Atma Sakha. They are friends. So they decide, the Atma says, okay, I need to live in this house because I have really a lot of karma. Why are we here? Because the ancient Indian Vedic wisdom says, we are here because of our karma. Okay, they are good, bad, indifferent karma. Whenever we are happy, we know that we are spending our good karma. Whenever we are sad, we know we are spending our bad karma, that's all. But we need a vehicle for spending this karma, and this vehicle is the body. Whenever I say body, it is not only the physical body, the senses and the mind. All together, please understand that the Prakriti part of it in us consists of the sthula body that we are seeing. You are able to see me, I am seeing you. Apart from that, the subtle part of it in us, the senses, the mind, the senses and the mind together. Mind has got three segments that we will not consider. Senses and mind. This together is the Prakriti part. The Purusha part is different and this is linked by the prana. So, if the Purusha wants to do something in the Prakriti, it does it through the prana. And that is why pranayama has an important role to play. First, why should this prana be dealt with at all? I told you there is a link between the Purusha and the Prakriti, and the most important part of the Prakriti in us is the mind. Chitta in yoga, and that is the mind. This mind is the one which is responsible for all activity. Whether I do some activity which leads me to papa, whether I do some activity which leads me to punya, it is because of the mind. Manayeva manushyana bandha moksha karanayoho atmaiva atmaji bandhu atmaiva vipuratmanaha. These are all quotations which say, mind is your best friend, mind is your worst enemy. So if you want to get rid of unhappiness, pain, and you want liberation, use this mind. So how do I use this mind? How do I use this mind? Because it is difficult to control mind, and that is why we have got dhyana techniques. For us to get into dhyana technique, it is basically pranayama which is going to help. How? The breath that we are inhaling and exhaling, which we call as vayu, is different from the prana. So next concept that we must know is the breathing in and breathing out that we are doing, we are taking the air in, but we are taking the air in, as we are taking the air in, we are taking the prana. Breath, vayu, is the vehicle of prana. Suppose if there is going to be an incense stick here, and it is lighted. So, the incense stick smell will come to you. How it is coming? Because the air is taking it, and the incense smell will come. If there is going to be some bad smell, that will also come. Because the air is the vehicle. Similarly, the air from the outside, the prana which is there, is brought in. So, breath is the vehicle of prana. Breath is the vehicle of prana, and prana is the vehicle of the mind. I told you prana and mind are linked. Prana is linking the Atma to the Prakriti, and so prana is the vehicle of mind. Where the prana goes, the mind will go. Where the prana moves, it will move. Chaleva, chalam chittam, nischale, nischalam bhavyate. So, prana is the vehicle of mind. Breath is the vehicle of prana. So, the equation is breath and mind are related. So, breath and mind are related. So, my inhalation and my exhalation are related to the mind. And my inhalation and exhalation are related to the mind. It is not simply a cardiovascular activity. It is not simply, of course, it does a lot of things with regard to that function. So, Dr. was talking about pulmonary specialists here. So, they have their own idea, scientific idea of what happens when you breathe in, breathe out. But the Shastras are talking about how it works with your mind. So, how breath can work? According to Shastras, how the breath can work is the breath is the vehicle of prana and prana is the vehicle of mind. They are all there in important Shastra, Shastra text. What is the aim of yoga? Okay, let it be. Let that be. Why should we control the mind at all? Why should we do something with the mind? And I told you mana eva manushyanam bandhakaranam, that are all different. But from yoga point of view, what is yoga? According to Yoga Sutra of Patanjali, the second sutra of the first chapter is yoga chitta vritti nirodha. In simple terms, yoga means control of mind. That's all. You can say chitta, mind, vritti, activities, functions, nirodha, stopping, control. When you control, stop the mind, that is yoga. So, you are not just stopping the mind, you are taking charge of the mind. The mind is now in charge of you. Now, you take charge of the mind, that becomes yoga. Yoga is any technique which takes you in a path where you get a control over your mind. The ability to focus on an object and sustain the focus without distraction. This is what our teacher Deshkata says as a quotation for the second sutra. So this ability to direct the mind and sustain the direction is achieved by prana. Tataha kshiyate prakasha avaranam dharanasune yogyata manasaha. Yoga Sutra in the second chapter, it says what happens when you do pranayama. Because even before we do something, we would like to know what is the purpose of that and what we achieve out of it. It says, if you do pranayama, sataha, kshiyate, falls down, it controls or it removes, kshiyate means removing, prakasha avarana, prakasha means light. There is a light inside and that light is covered, avarana means it is covered, the tube light is there. Supposing we paint this tube light with a dark color, a tar or something, then it loses its light and we may not know that there is a light there. But the moment you start rubbing it out, the light comes. Similarly, there is a light in us, the light of consciousness, the light of right knowledge, that is covered with something outside. And that ajnana, avarana is removed by pranayama. Dharanasuja yogyata manasaha. A second, in fact, this is one technique, pranayama, one of the anga, for which there are two results given. This is not given for everyone. It is only given for specifically pranayama, because it has got two functions. One is, it removes the impurities of the mind and makes it fit for direction towards the chosen object. Dharana suche yogyata manasaha. It takes you to the next step of dharana. That is why we often feel that people come to us and ask us, can you teach me only meditation? I think I am old. Now I won't be able to move on. I cannot do anything. Can you teach me meditation? I wouldn't say it is impossible, but it is very difficult. I can say it's very simple. All of us close your eyes and repeat a mantra, or you repeat a number. And this is one of the techniques of, there are various techniques of meditation. This is one of the techniques of meditation. How long you can do and what will be the result? After a few minutes, you would like to see the watch and say, let me get up. I'm not getting into this. So it is not very, very simple. We are all not like the Ramana Maharishi, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, who were able to get into the state of Samadhi at the 11th year, 10th year. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa will be just sitting. And he always, the moment that there was a good song here going on, I was reminded. And anyone comes and meets Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, he says, please sing. And then the moment they start singing, he will get into Samadhi. Immediately, probably if he was here, he would have gone into Samadhi. That was his natural state. But that natural state cannot be coming to every one of us. So how to get into that state of Jnana, which leads to Samadhi, pranayama is the way. And for pranayama, asana is also an important role to play. Tasmin sati, swasa, prashvasayoho, gati, vicheta, pranayama. So first, before I get into the sutra, let me recall, I told you what is pranayama. It is one of the Ashtanga yogas. It is coming in the middle, the importance of it. What does the word mean? What is prana means? What is ayama mean? And what is the link between prana and mind? The link between breath and prana, and naturally the link between breath and the mind. Now, is there first any idea as to what is pranayama from the definition point of view? I told you so many things. So the Yoga Sutra says, tasmin sati, after doing something, that is asana, we will leave that word. Swasa, prashwasa. Swasa means inhalation. Prashwasa means exhalation. Swasa, prashwasa. This is another word all of you would have heard. If somebody, they will say, oh, this swasa prashwasa is very bad. Will the person be alive for some more time? They will say, swasa prashwasa, uncontrolled breathing. Swasa and prashwasa is uncontrolled breathing. Breathing going haywire. And when swasa prashwasa, which is uncontrolled, is brought under control, swasa prashwasa yoho gati, movement, vichyeta, break. You break into the involuntary movement of the breathing. The moment you break into that, pranayama has already started. You don't have to hold your nose with your hand. That is death. It is a technique. And holding the nose like this, without taking charge of the breath, will not give the desired result of pranayama. So, you can keep holding, or you may even touch and take off. But the first and foremost criteria for doing pranayama and saying I am doing pranayama is you must take charge of the breath. Unless you take charge of the breath, you have not gone into pranayama. So how do I take charge of the breath? That is what the next sutra will say. But let us understand one thing. Supposing I have not given you any idea. Supposing I am saying, now just hold the breath. Supposing the moment I say hold the breath, and I ask you to hold the breath, even if I continue to talk or do something, you won't be able to hear me. And if I ask you to hold for a few more seconds, you know, your attention will be only in your breath, because it is life. The breath is life. And the life, and they have, after a few seconds, maybe you will hold and hear me, but you can't do it for a long time. The moment you put your mind into the breath, which is holding, you know, immediately your mind will come there. If you give, go away from all other attention. In fact, when you are very attentive also, you can see you don't know whether you are breathing, even when you are looking at television or other activity. So, this link between first step of pranayama is to take charge of the breath and enter into the activity, the movement of the breathing, which is prana, because breath is equal to prana, breath is the vehicle of prana. You can't do directly anything with breath, prana. Similarly, you can't do anything directly with the mind even. So only through breath, which is possible. So breath is the conscious way. The moment you start doing a conscious breathing, you are already starting pranayama. And what is the technique? What is there? Is there any technique for doing this? Is what I'm going to give you only one technique aspect. After that, I will leave that. And then maybe we can have a small session of a practice. Okay. Now, what is the technique for entering into this? Is there a technique required, or can we do it by ourselves? Because we are dealing with the life, because breath is life, and holding the breath may cause so many problems. Even doctors will tell us to go on holding the breath without knowing the correct technique, it may do some damage. It may not be possible, because the nature has done such a way that you won't be able to hold the breath. Somewhere it will go away. In fact, there are 9 holes through which it will go away. It can go through any other hole and it can come. Navadvara. In fact, the body is supposed to be consisting of the 9 holes, you know, 2 eyes, 2 ears, 2 nose, 1 mouth, 7, and 2 below the navel. So these are the 9. The 9 dwaras through which it can go out and come. In fact, when it's also prana, it goes out and comes. So, even if you decide to hold the breath, somehow it will escape. Unless somebody takes to life by holding it and then no. So, how do one take control, charge of the breathing? So, there is a technique for that. The technique involves using the abdominal muscles. Breathing is happens only at the level of the chest, and there is a system through which you are taking the air in, and it goes into the chest, and there is a diaphragm where it works. So this is all that's actually happening. It's mostly related to chest. There is hardly anything that is related. The air does not go below the diaphragm, but there is a lot of things that can be done in the way of breathing by working on the diaphragm, below the diaphragm, the muscles. And this is brought out in how, with the right technique of breathing, which I will make you do as you do this, as I propose to do that today. There is a physiology of breathing. There are books which talks about the correct technique of breathing, and they call it as diaphragmatic breathing. And call it as diaphragmatic breathing, using the diaphragm instead of just the cavity of the chest alone, or thoracic breathing. They call it as thoracic breathing. But using that, diaphragmatic breathing helps a lot. There's still a lot of research going on that about what is the benefits of diaphragmatic breathing. Now, why, before all this idea of diaphragm and all came, you know, our shastras were existing, how do they talk about this correct technique of breathing? It is coming in the Bhagavad Gita. It is coming in the Bhagavad Gita in the 4th chapter, 29th verse. Apane chukvati pranam. Apane chukvati pranam. Prane apanam tatapare. Prane apanam tatapare. Prana apana gati buddhaha. Prana apana gati buddhaha. Pranayama Parayama. In the 4th chapter, it talks about various yajnas, offerings through which one can reach the highest. So, one of the offering itself is pranayama. Pranayama is nothing but an offering, yajna. Yajna comes from the word yajipujayama, which is worshipping. So there are various ways of worship. There are various ways of yajna. The word sacrifice for yajna is not a total translation. We can better say worship. Because there is one way of sacrificing something into that is yajna. So, apane jukvati pranam. Poor, jukva means to poor. Poor prana into apana. Apane, in the apana, jukvati poor prana. Apane jukvati pranam. Prane apanam tadapare. Poor the apana into prana. Poor the apana into prana. Prana apana gadi ruddha. The movement of the prana and apana, ruddha means to stop. Pranayama, aparayama. So people worship, do yajna, one way of doing is there. What does this have to do with the right technique of breathing? So what is this prana and what is this apana? There are pancha prana. The prana, the life energy that we have, is five. Maha pancha prana, there are upa prana. There are pancha prana, prana, apana, vyana, udana, samana. There are places where this prana, in fact the same prana, the same single prana has got five such names. How can one have five names? That is the generally the example that I give you. Let us take our own case. We are a father to our children. Grandfather to our grandchildren, then maybe if I am a teacher, I am teachers to the student, the same single person, if a doctor, the doctor is a doctor to the patient, the same doctor is a doctor to the patient, father to the children, similarly, the same prana, when it works at five segments of the body and gives five functions, it becomes pancha prana. So prana, which is responsible for breathing, which is in the chest. Apana, which is responsible for elimination, which is in the lower abdomen, below the navel. So this segment of the body where the prana works for elimination is called, the name of the prana itself becomes apana because it eliminates. Apana means that which eliminates. So that is the process of elimination for which the prana is helping, is function. So below the navel part where the prana is working, to eliminate is apana. Prana is in the chest. Vyana is all over the body. Udana is in the kantakupa, that is in the throat. Samana is just above the belly. So these are the five. So the part relating to apana is lower abdomen. The part relating to prana is upper abdomen. Now look at it. Apane doyarapan chukvati pur prana. Throw the air from the chest to the abdomen. What is it? It is in here. And throw the air from apana to prana, exhalation. So the process of using the chest abdomen in between the diaphragm is there is stated in this Bhagavad Gita 4th chapter 29. So, first lesson that we try to introduce towards pranayama is how to use the abdominal muscles for the purpose of efficiently breathing. So, with this it is 6:40. I will stop here. If you have any questions, I will answer. I will just give a 5 minutes of experience of this technique of breathing. After that, we will discuss. Can I respond to any questions? Okay, good. Yeah.
Can you please throw some light on transcendental meditation?
Yeah, I'll get that.
Come back to this question. No, the other thing, Prana is not in meditation.
No, I can answer you. But I answer you. Okay. Shall we do that? Yeah, please ask me the question. I will answer your question.
Or pranayama, sometimes our eyes get burning and body gets heated up and sometimes sometimes you get old-sided, you concentrate too much, sometimes you get talachitta. What is the reason?
I think the best the doctor says is, I will answer your question, it's pretty important. Please sit there, right? Please put your feet slightly away, because those of you who are sitting in the chair, I don't want your spine to be supported by the, because in pranayama the first and most important requirement about the body is, you have to keep your spine erected. In fact, Bhagavad Gita says, samakaya tiro grivam dharayana chalam siraha. That is for the meditation. The same holds for pranayama. Samakaya tiro grivam. Kaya means body. Griva means neck. Sira means hip. So you have to keep your neck, body and head in alignment with the back erect. So you keep your feet slightly away, you can see the back becomes correct. Keep your head down, eyes closed. Keep one palm on your navel. Keep one palm on the navel. Eyes closed. Keep the other palm in Chin Mudra on the knee, on the other knee. For example, if all of you can keep your left palm on the navel, the right palm will be in Chin Mudra, the right knee. Just close the eyes. Don't press your navel. Just keep your, as if it is touching. Eyes closed is ideal. Eyes closed is important. The moment you close your eyes, keep your head down. You are not going to do pranayama with your nose holding out. No, nose is not felt. Now, just look at, watch your breathing. You can see some movements happening at the navel itself. That you can feel only if you close the eye, keep your palm on the navel. I want to give half a minute for that. Just watch. Just watch, eyes closed, head down, keep the palm on the navel, there will be a movement. And it will be very, very light. Don't press your hand. Now, we are going to start with one technique. All of you will say aloud, bit longer. Open the mouth. As you say Ra, slowly contract the abdomen at the level of the navel. At the level of the navel, contract the abdomen. Now, take a short inhale, say Ra. Ra. Contract the abdomen. Just wait. Now, inhale, release the abdomen. You would have contracted. Take the breath in through the nostrils. Inhale, release the abdomen. Now again, say Ra. Ra. For a second. Now inhale, release the abdomen. Slowly palm will come out. Third time, say Ra. Ra. Inhale, release the abdomen. Two more times we will do. Say Ra. Ra. Last time, say Ra. Ra. Contract the abdomen as you say Ra. Wait, now release the abdomen. Inhale. Finish. We have done 5 times. So, first, in the breathing, any activity relating to speech. Now I am speaking. They were all doing chant, singing. The activity of singing, speech, chanting, throws the air outside. It is an activity of exhalation actually. It is an activity of exhalation. The only thing is it comes through the mouth. The air is coming. The air from the system, you know, goes into the vocal cord and touches and comes out. Of course, the air also comes out through the nostrils, no doubt about it. But we are using a lot of air for this. In fact, that is why if you sing for a very long time or if you chant, talk, you will be losing a lot of prana. Now, what you did is a sort of forced exhalation. You forced exhalation and to see how you can contract the abdomen on exhale is this exercise. So, this activity of contracting the abdomen as you are saying aloud Ram, you know, will give you the initial idea. In fact, if you lie down and do it, you will be more, you can see easily how this is helping. Now I will end up, just close the eyes, keep the palm there. Now, instead of Ram, you are going to exhale through the nostril, not through mouth. Close the mouth, head down, eyes closed. Just start exhaling, contract the abdomen. Exhale through the nostril, contract the abdomen, synchronize. Wait, inhale, release the abdomen. Inhale, your breathing capacity will be different because we are doing together, I am taking about 6 seconds. Now exhale, contract the abdomen. Contract the abdomen as if the navel is going behind. The navel is going behind. Wait. Now inhale, release the abdomen. Inhale, release the abdomen. Third breath. Exhale, contract the abdomen. Inhale, release. Two more breaths. Exhale, contract. Abdomen is contracted. The navel is taken behind as if it is going towards the spine. Now inhale, release. The navel will come forward. The hand is there to show. The hand is not there to push actually. Final breath, one more breath. Exhale, contract the navel, contract the abdomen below and above the navel, below and above the navel. Actually, the diaphragm is going up now as you exhale and contract. Wait and inhale and release. Keep the palm down. But first, actually, this will be more better seen if I make you lie down on the back with your leg on a stool or bed. So this is the first lesson, I would say, in pranayama. I will answer these two questions.
Thank you very much, sir. I request Mr. Sarvanarayanan to come out and give us the Pranayama story. Sir, your allocation time is 30 minutes, sir.